This video is sponsored by AG1 by Athletic Greens. Water is a vital resource, yet many countries worldwide face severe water shortages every year. And not just developing countries. Just think of the Flint, Michigan crisis. Imagine pulling clean, drinkable water right out of thin air. Sounds like something from Dune or Star Wars, right? But atmospheric water generation is very real. And thanks to some major scientific leaps, AWG technology may soon find its way into your home. Today, we're going to explore three promising AWG breakthroughs. Could these technologies solve at-home water independence and global water shortages? Let's dive in. So, to begin with, how can the blue planet have water shortages? Yes, water covers 70% of our planet, but we're only able to use about 3%. The rest ends up in our oceans. We've done a video on desalination, so you should definitely check that out. But the stark truth is that for now, the amount of usable water is shrinking. Reasons include population growth, more and more people using up our water supplies. This gets compounded when you factor in agriculture, which uses up 70 to 80% of our water by itself. In the US alone, leaky pipes waste roughly 6 billion gallons of water per day. Our house alone had a 400 gallon per day leak, which we didn't even know about until I got a water meter and tracked it down. We'll have a link to that video in the description. Climate change related droughts also factor in. As clouds move away from the equator and towards the poles, leaving already vulnerable regions high and dry. At the time of this video, 1.1 billion people worldwide lack access to clean water, and nearly 2.7 billion people live in water-scarce areas. Some estimates predict that by 2050, roughly 87 countries will be in a state of water scarcity. Right now, about 30% of the Earth's fresh water lies deep underground in aquifers. While many developed countries have the technology and infrastructure to dig wells, not every country does. Even in developed places like California, most of our fresh water comes from out of state. Geopolitics, water management, and budget can all play major factors in accessing clean water. As we mentioned, extracting water from the ocean is possible through desalination, which is likely to play a vital role in the coming years. But the process can be expensive and requires loads of energy, not to mention you have to have an ocean nearby. But the ocean isn't the only place to find usable water. In fact, there is an enormous pool of water literally surrounding you right now. The Earth's atmosphere. It's estimated that our atmosphere carries about 12,900 cubic kilometers of water at any given time. That's about three times the amount of water humans consume annually. So, like the kid looking into the candy store, the question isn't what we want, but how we get it. Let's step back and talk about how air from water systems work and the different physical properties at play. First, it's not the heat, it's the humidity. Absolute humidity is the amount of moisture in the air, but it's not as useful as you might think. That's because the air's ability to hold water is largely due to temperature. Oh, so maybe it is the heat. This graph shows how many kilograms of water 1 kilogram of air can hold at different temperatures. Interestingly, at 0 degrees Celsius, there's nearly no water in the air, giving the air that bitter cold sensation that hurts your lungs when you breathe in. As temperatures rise, air can hold more water. So instead of absolute humidity, it's more helpful to think about relative humidity. How much water is in the air versus how much it could possibly hold at a given temperature. Next is the dew point, which is the temperature at which air is saturated with water, meaning 100% relative humidity. Here, water condenses out of the air since the air can't hold anymore. Picture a kitchen sponge. When dry, it can soak up water. But once it's full, it can't hold anymore. The air actually works in pretty much the same way. So by tweaking this dew point and exploiting this phenomenon, we can extract water out of air. This then is at the heart of all the various breakthroughs we'll talk about today. And speaking of water, let me take a quick moment and tell you about our sponsor this week, AG1 by Athletic Greens. Now, this isn't the first time I've talked about AG1. That's because I've been a very happy customer for over a year. I only have a few years before I turn 40. And after years of working hard, growing this channel at the cost of my health, I've decided to make a change. I'm eating better, I've lost 10 pounds, and I drink AG1 every day. Have you ever wondered if between your meals, you've gotten all the vitamins and minerals your body needs each day? Well, AG1 has 75 different ingredients, including vitamins, minerals, superfoods, probiotics, and adaptogens. Things like vitamin C, zinc, and healing mushrooms to support your immunity. probiotics for gut health, a natural form of B12, biotin, bioavailable folate, and magnesium for energy, and much more. AG1 is even vegan, paleo, and keto friendly. Between this channel and my boys, my life is complicated enough, but AG1 really helps me simplify nutrition. Go to athleticgreens.com/tubadavinci to get started on your first purchase and receive a free one-year supply of vitamin D and 5 travel packs. Huge thanks to Athletic Greens and you for supporting the show. First up is a system by Tsunami Products, which uses a forced condenser system. These work similar to your refrigerator or air conditioner. The machine pulls out moist ambient air through a series of condensing coils, where the water vapor is cooled down sufficiently to reach the dew point. Then the air and moisture go through special patented extraction chambers, which condense the water even further. Finally, the water passes through a series of filters, then collects in a storage tank ready for tapping. According to the company, the smaller unit, the Tsunami 500, can produce between 0.5 and 8 gallons per hour, or up to 200 gallons per day, depending on the air temperature, relative humidity, and dew point where it is installed. The larger Tsunami 750 produces up to 330 gallons per day. What would this look like for the average consumer? According to the EPA, the average American uses roughly 82 gallons of water per day, with the average household using about 300 gallons. So even with the smaller unit, you'd be able to produce over 60% of your daily water needs, or about 3 times your daily needs if you're single. And the Tsunami 750, their bigger system, could potentially provide all the water you would need for your entire family. It's pretty amazing. But there's more to the story. These units aren't cheap. While the company's website doesn't list an official price, reports suggest that the Tsunami 500 could cost a whopping $30,000. And the 750, about $50,000. But it's not just the upfront cost either. These systems require external power. The 500 model uses about 7.5 kilowatts per hour, while the 750 uses around 11. For context, a window air conditioner uses around 1 kilowatt per hour, and a large whole house AC about 4.5 kilowatts. Level 2 charging for my Tesla Model 3 uses between 7 and 9 kilowatts per hour. These then are serious energy hogs. Even if you have solar, you need an absolutely massive system to power them. Plus, if you only run them when producing solar, you can easily cut that water generation in half, since at night you're not gonna be running it, if not more. I'm actually looking into an air water generation system for my net zero home build, so we'll have a lot more hands-on videos covering this stuff in the future, but I would love to do something like this. One more thing to note though, is that these systems have lifespans of 20 years or more, which may help justify the high upfront cost. We'll do a cost comparison breakdown looking at each technology later in the video. Up next, let's look at the technology that's basically the exact opposite of these active condenser models. We all know nets can be great for catching fish out of the water, but what about using them to catch the water itself? Fog nets have been around for quite a while, using small fibers to capture and condense water from the air. But these systems typically only work in foggy or high humidity regions. But a recent breakthrough by researcher Josh Wong and his team at the University of Akron in Ohio have taken this very simple technology to a whole new level. The team used electrospun polymer nanofibers with diameters of 1/1,000,000th of a meter, about 3.5 atoms in width. These nanofibers greatly increase the relative surface area of the nets, allowing more water to condense on the surface. According to the creators, a typical fog net can capture roughly 30 liters of water per day per square meter. These nanofiber nets can yield up to 180 liters, about 6 times the output. Best of all, they require no electricity. However, Wong is developing a system that could use an electric cooling device to help cool the fibers, increasing the amount of water they can collect even further. Because this technology is still in the experimental stages, getting into things like cost per unit can be tricky. But the researchers' goal is to create a system that is lightweight, durable, and cost-effective. The increased condensing abilities mean that these nets can work in areas that aren't particularly humid. In fact, according to Wong, these materials will work in areas where humidity levels are as low as 4%. That is bone dry. The final breakthrough utilizes an emerging technology known as the super sponge. Super sponges are a wide-ranging group of hydrogel and gel polymer hybrid materials, essentially chemical compounds with interlocked repeating elements. You actually can see them at work in bandages, diapers, or even contact lenses. What makes them so special, though, is that they are incredibly hydrophilic, meaning in cold temperatures, they can condense and absorb large amounts of water. When they heat up under solar radiation, they become hydrophobic, meaning that they expel all that water they absorbed. So, like the nanofiber nets, these systems don't need need to consume any electricity to work. They just need solar input. A team of researchers at the University of Texas in Austin, led by Guihua Yu, have harnessed these materials to create a unique water harvesting and filtration system. This version of the gel can produce between 30 and 40 liters per kilogram per day. Again, this particular hydrogel is still in the lab, but other hydrogels can cost between $2,600 and $3,400 per ton, which comes out to about $3 to $4 per kilogram. So how do these technologies compare? And when, where, and how might each one best fit? In terms of power consumption, it's pretty straightforward. Tsunami product systems use between 7 and 11 kilowatt hours of power every day, while the nanofiber nets and hydrogel systems require no active power at all. In terms of longevity, the Tsunami product systems are rated to last over 20 years, a significant edge over the other two. Again, being in the experimental phases, it's hard to say for sure how long these technologies would last in the real world, but traditional fog nets tend to last roughly 10 years, while hydrogels generally last around 7 years. Hydrogels also tend to be biodegradable, a factor that the other two don't share. Finally, let's look at cost. The average American household uses roughly 300 gallons of water per day, 9,000 gallons monthly, or 108,000 gallons annually. Right now in California, water is priced in hundreds of cubic feet, or HCF. One HCF equaling roughly 750 gallons of water. I know, our units are stupid. But please feel free to leave that in the comment section. Pricing uses a tiered system, as shown. At 300 gallons a day, that comes out to 12 HCF monthly. With a base fee of $27, that means an average monthly water bill here in San Diego, where I live, is between $80 and $100 a month, which is less than a penny a gallon. The Tsunami 500 costs $30,000 up front, and it lasts 20 years and produces 200 gallons per day. That means in its lifetime, it can produce up to 1.5 million gallons of water. At that rate, it comes out to about 2 cents per gallon. But remember, 200 gallons is still less than what the average U.S. household consumes in a day. So even with this machine, you'd have to have a water connection to make up the difference. Then you have to factor in your electricity bill, assuming you don't have home solar. Even if we conservatively estimate 10 hours of use a day at 10 kilowatts, that's 100 kilowatt hours per day, or 3,000 per month. In San Diego, 33 cents per kilowatt hour, we're looking at $1,000 per month just for this system. Sadly, you'd never be able to justify this system financially. While pricing for the nanofiber net isn't currently available, pricing for a standard fog net today costs around $37 per square meter and can last about 10 years. According to Wong and his team, one square meter of this nanofiber could yield 47 gallons of water per day, which means you'd need a little over 6 square meters of nanofiber to produce the 300 gallons you'd need each day. Based on standard fog net pricing, that would come out to about $236. But I have a feeling their electro-spun nanofiber is going to cost substantially more than that. Over 10 years, this system could theoretically produce over 1 million gallons of water, which comes out to 2 tenths of a penny per gallon. Based on San Diego water prices, you're looking at a payback period of 3 to 4 months. But again, the real prices could be dramatically higher. And remember, this system requires no electricity. Now again, this product is not yet commercially available, but you could see why it would be so attractive. Finally, the hydrogel. Again, we didn't have pricing for the specific gel, but based on their commercially available products, we can estimate about $4 per kilogram. According to the researchers, 1 kilogram can produce about 9 gallons of water per day, which means we'll need about 33 kilograms to meet our daily quota, which comes out to $132. Again, theoretically. But assume the gel can last 7 years, that's a lifetime production of over 766,000 gallons at a price of 1/10 of a penny per gallon, and a payback period of just 1 or 2 months. Now, of course, these numbers should be taken with a sizable grain of salt, as 2 of the 3 technologies aren't even commercially available yet. Things like price, longevity, durability are all highly speculative at this point. Seeing just how much energy the conventional condensing system uses, you start to realize why so much research is going into nets and gels that are passive. So yes, 10 kilowatts per hour is wildly expensive, but if I was facing a water shortage and I could power this system with my solar panels, it is hard to put a price on that life-giving water production. While these systems may not make financial sense for the average American home, perhaps they could find uses in rural or underdeveloped communities. Plus, it's not all sunshine and rainbows for the passive systems either. Both the gel and the net systems require wind to push air through the various media. Plus, output figures are wildly theoretical, with changes in temperature, relative humidity, and dew point throughout the day. Much more real-world testing would be required to truly understand their performance. There is one other commercially available product I've had my eye on, and that's the Source Hydro Panel by Zero Mass Water. This water-powered panel mounts on your roof and produces water from air entirely powered by the solar power on board. This 4x8-foot panel can produce 4 to 8 liters of water per day, depending on the day's humidity and weather. And at $6,000 for two panels shipped and installed, you could produce 8 to 16 liters or 2 to 4 gallons a day. Sure, you need 100 panels and $600,000 to produce all 300 gallons you'd need for a day, but come on, water out of air, all day, every day. As you can probably tell, I'm pretty passionate about this. Water is a major concern for us here in California and in San Diego. So I'm actually looking into one of these systems for my house to see if it would be possible to make all the water I would need on site every day. So subscribe and stay tuned, because on our net zero build series on this channel, we'll cover this way more in the future. So water, sure, it's everywhere, but it's quite tricky to use as we need it. But in our current climate, it's one of the greatest challenges of our time, which is why I'm so glad to know that so many smart people around the world are working on this problem, and every new idea and breakthrough matters. But let us know what you think. Which of these technologies has you the most excited? Are there any other water shortage solutions you'd like us to cover in the future? Sound off in the comments below. All right, so that's a look at cool, innovative ways of producing water out of the air. This is one of those things I'm really pumped on. I have a couple of DIY ideas that I'm playing with. Possibly, picture this, a pool heat pump heater where the cold side blows in to a water capture system. So now I'm heating my pool and producing water, or something like that. I got a bunch of stuff I'm cooking up. So subscribe and we'll cover all my findings in future videos. All right, that's a look at water from air. Check out some of our other videos we think you'll like. I'm Rico Tipi Da Vinci. Catch you guys next week.